orange juice. Get hype.
Shot of Hennessy, spike the wet tamale.
A drug as dangerous as cocaine, Molly.
Molly is a hot drug.
Molly can kill.
Pop the Molly, I'm sweating.
Popping Molly's and sweating may be what's hot in the clubs right now, but pop culture's hottest new street drug has been around longer than you might think. In the early 80s, people were buying a drug called Sassafras. Since then, MDMA has undergone many name changes, but the seduction remains the same. Meet its newest image, Molly.
You've had Molly before. What was it like?
It was f***ing awesome.
Make you feel real good.
Molly's ecstasy on steroids.
The reason why, you know, I believe that the drug dealers started using the term Molly is to really kind of give it an innocent name, but actually MDMA is one of the least innocent drugs that's available on the black market today.
Says we, moonshine and Molly.
From Rihanna's love songs to Rick Ross's cryptic messages of date rape.
Put Molly all in her champagne.
Molly is the leading lady in mainstream music right now. EDM, hip-hop, top 40 radio, musicians across the board are glamorizing the hottest designer drug.
Molly with LA.
I know that drugs have had a long-term presence in all of music scenes, whether that be electronic dance music, rock music, Jimi Hendrix, psychedelic rock, rap, everything.
A lot of these rappers and stuff are like, kids look up to him. They're like, oh, if he's doing it, I can be doing it.
Everybody's taking it. I mean, I know cheerleaders, football players taking Molly.
Molly is a drug tempting enough to bring all types of people together. It's often found in raves and dance clubs, but what's scarier, kids too young to get into the clubs are using Molly too.
They get introduced to it in all kinds of ways. 14, 15, and I hate seeing them that young.
And it's not hard to find.
It's absolutely the easiest probably thing that you can get.
And it's just easy as hell to get a hold of.
And Molly is affordable. This isn't coke or meth, where a gram can cost up to $250. It's a drug any kid can afford with a weekend job or allowance.
One capsule, depending on who you're getting it from, where you're getting it, between $15 and $20.
No matter the differences in age, lifestyle, or income, one thing your average Joe user and his favorite Molly poppin' celeb have in common, they're in love with the high.
You will feel the best feeling you ever felt in your life. It makes you extremely happy.
Love and happiness may be what users crave while they roll, but does that craving end when you decide to stop rolling?
It's not necessarily a physical addiction, but it is a very intense psychological addiction.
You're hyped up, you're moving, you're having fun. So you're psychologically, you're like, man, I just can't have fun without it.
Okay, so you might not experience physical addiction when you're taking pure MDMA, but there's no way to be positive that's what you're getting.
Whenever you buy Molly, people are mixing these things with hydrocodone, they're mixing it with BC powder, baking soda. You never know what they're mixing it with.
I had 2CI and acid mixed with our Molly one time, and it was absolutely awful.
And those are just the risks you run, assuming you live to tell the story.
A lot of the deaths that you see from MDMA are people actually overheating because they're at raves or they're at parties dancing too long. They become dehydrated, but their body feels so good that they don't notice that they're actually about to die.
There's a big risk in taking a Molly. The risk they're taking is they may not wake up the next day.
Basically breaks down all your inhibitions, yet you're able to communicate more effectively than if you just drank a bunch of alcohol. And so people feel very connected to one another.
And that emotional connection is what makes some think it may be good for therapy. Even in the medical world, Molly has advocates and naysayers. Some doctors hope the drug can be used to treat disorders like PTSD.
People with PTSD, they isolate themselves, they numb themselves. MDMA may be able to kind of loosen that up.
People have looked for shortcuts for years for PTSD. There's got to be a shortcut someplace. There's got to be a fast food drive-thru that you can do this. It just doesn't work.
We need to open ourselves to new treatments. MDMA offers promise.
But does the research warrant the optimism?
The studies I saw were very weak. I would not consider prescribing based on these studies.
The studies that have been done so far, in my opinion, are certainly promising.
From doctors and counselors to teens and celebs, Molly's making her mark with no discrimination. And what's even more unsettling, the opinions are all so different on the drug, the powers it may possess, and the reach of its wrath.
and I can't seem to find Molly.
It make you feel real good.
MDMA is a very scary drug.
It releases more serotonin in your brain, so you're awfully happy.
It kills your brain cells. It destroys your life.
Please help me find Molly.
So have you seen Molly? A lot of people have, but no one's sure who she'll turn out to be.
On December 21st, 1999, I was in New York City.
On our way home, when I was walking out to the car, one of our friends came to pick us up.
A guy came up from behind, put his arm around me, and said, "Don't scream. I've got a gun, and I want to f*** you."
Then I was kidnapped and raped.
We came to a stairwell, and he said, "We're going down here." It was just an empty stairwell. And there he proceeded to beat, rape, and sodomize me.
But I obviously knew what they were up to when they pulled me into the car. So they raped me one at a time, two at a time, three at a time. It lasted, the police report, I didn't know at that time, but said that it lasted for 79 minutes until the police found me.
I screamed, "Somebody help me." And he hit me so hard that I thought, "That's it, I'm done."
I thought that every breath that I took would be my last.
He said, "What's wrong with you?" And I was shaking so much, I just turned and looked at him, dead set in the eyes, and said, "You just raped me. What the hell do you think is wrong with me?"
They took duct tape around my eyes and pushed me out of the van and told me to run. So I did. I ran for a long time. I don't know how long.
There's the sense of fear, there's shock, there's anger, you know, and kind of, where do I go from here?
I felt like a doll, like I wasn't a person of importance anymore.
Nobody needs to live through that.
In my head, I've been over that night over and over and over, and I've been talking about it over and over, and you come to a certain point when you kind of let it go.
Rape is a horrible, awful thing, and it takes a while, and it's baby steps.
It's been long. It's been a lot of nightmares and fear of going out, fear of meeting strangers, but I found out that I just have to do something, and I have to do it myself. That's the thing. You have to make a decision to move on.
For me, the rape will always be with me. It doesn't define me. But there are still times that things will slip up and I have to remember, oh yeah, that's a trigger. And you know, I just know how to deal with those things now.
There's times where you beg, like, I just wish that I could wake up the next morning and that it would have been like before, that this just wouldn't happen to me, but it did. And it's, you just have to fight through it.
I want to let people know that, and especially women, if you're going through this, talk about it. Get help. It's okay. There is light at the end of the tunnel, and there are thousands of people that are willing to help you. Just reach out. You are not alone. I think society still has some stigmatism of, we don't talk about this if it happens. And that's not okay, because that's the only way people heal.
I think people are scared, and that they kind of have to blame the victim to tell themselves that I wouldn't put myself in a situation like that.
It could never happen to me.
It couldn't happen to me because I dress the right way and I don't go out late at night and I don't do this and that. You know, I think that's a form of protection for people.
It's not just the person that goes through the rape, it's also the friends and the family.
That's the thing, it doesn't only affect the victim. It affects family, it affects friends.
Still to this day, my dad, you know, he tears up, and it breaks my heart because I'm okay. And I'm sorry that I put them through that, even though it's not my fault. I would never wish this on my worst enemy, because it is hell. Not just for yourself, but for everybody that loves you.
I want people to realize that it's more than just a police case or more than just a news case. It's actually a life that can be ruined. So I think it's sad when we watch the news and people just turn the TV off and that's it. It was just a news case, because it's not. It's a life.
Got them Dust Bowl Blues.
The richest grazing land on earth had become a desert.
Water is a critical resource, and everybody has to have it.
Come on, give me good water.
Man has only one source of water.
The time has come for man to make his peace with nature.
Our demands for water are growing, and we only have limited supply.
I think for everyone, it's a very serious issue.
New world water, and every drop counts.
Americans have the right to believe that government is doing everything it can to keep water systems safe.
I think in some areas, water is in jeopardy.
Yes, it's a big issue, and it's a hard issue. But we have resources available to us.
Fracking, which shoots waters and chemicals into rock, is dangerous for water supply.
I am not aware of any proven case where the fracking process itself has affected water.
Our ability to get water is going to not increase as rapidly as our demand is going to increase.
There's continual evaluation going on.
This is an issue that's not going to go away.
So who's to blame? Is it municipal use, households, manufacturing, agriculture, fracking, watering lawns, watering concrete, irrigation, broken sprinklers, fountains, golf courses, swimming pools, flushing toilets, washing cars, washing clothes, washing dishes, damming rivers? The answer is probably all of the above. But why is it so hard to conserve?
They don't conserve water because it's not expensive.
Now that is an interesting thought. Could it really be that simple? All we need to do to save our water supply is raise the price?
I don't know that we fully understand what impact raising water prices drastically would have.
The economics of water is sort of backwards.
So what does that mean? Well, the less you supply, the higher your cost. It's a basic economic principle, but it doesn't always apply to water. That's because in many cities, utility companies set the price. But since they're a nonprofit, they can only set that price high enough to recover their cost. And as a result, prices remain low and people consume accordingly.
That's my concern, is that supply and demand is not being addressed in water. At some point, we're not going to be able to get that water that we need.
It is a balancing act. It has to be affordable for people on a fixed income because you need water to live. But remember, we also have to meet our revenue requirements. We have to cover our costs.
This is not champagne, it's not white wine, it's not olive oil. This is water. And so if we raise the price much, we've got to make sure we're raising it in such a way that we're not hurting those on the lowest end of society, because that can do real harm to them, while others might just absorb the cost.
And it's easy to see why, looking at Dallas's tiered water prices. The price you pay for the first 1,000 gallons of water is less than the grande coffee at Starbucks. Even the biggest water users only pay the cost of a couple frappuccinos. Seems cheap, right? Now why not hike up the price?
You put all of it in the very top end, and everybody says, ooh, I'm not gonna do that anymore, then you're not gonna cover your cost.
So there's your catch-22. Studies confirm exactly that. The more you charge, the more people conserve, which leaves little room for growth.
We're not paying the amount it's going to take to build the next reservoir we're going to need for expansion of the water into the future.
But with Dallas's population climbing, climate changing, and lake levels declining, the question remains.
Are we going to get to a point where we run out of water? There are some cities in Texas that are desperate for water right now. It's a precious resource, and it can go away in a heartbeat.
Susan was the first of the cheerleaders, myself, his girlfriend, and his girlfriend's sister was raped.
One by one, Lisa Gabbert says a rapist targeted her Castleberry High School cheerleading squad.
I was awakened and looked over and saw someone in a mask.
Then 18-year-old Gabbert was victim 3 by 6, the rapist-turned-killer, stabbing Retha Stratton to death. The man was Wesley Wayne Miller, who Gabbert says raped in 4 Tarrant County cities, using the same methods before he was caught.
Looking back through the police reports, some of the things are similar, and we can pick those out as laymen, and so it does seem pretty unfortunate that those dots were not connected sooner.
It's not uncommon. Sexual assault advocates say often it's hard to connect serial rapists to a string of crimes because of what happens after the rape. Experts say in Texas, investigators don't follow a standard list of questions presented to the victim after the attack. Some might ask,
did the offender pay particular attention to any item, piece of clothing, or body part?
While another might ask this,
did the offender bite any body part?
We have varying degrees of interviewing skills.
Deborah Caddy, director of the Women's Center, says police need to adopt uniform standards for rape questioning to catch mobile predators.
What we know about sexual predators is that they move around. They move from city to city, they can move from state to state, and we know that. And we know that these predators never strike just one time.
This one is my police report.
Gabbert says whether it's better questioning or better training for officers, she wants change and is willing to push lawmakers to get it, to help remedy mistakes of the past.
We do need to reach that common ground where everybody's speaking the same language.
When I was diagnosed on March 13, 1984, I was told, you have AIDS.
When I was first diagnosed, I was like devastated. I thought I was gonna die.
I felt like, you know, that was it. I don't have anywhere else to go. I'm gonna die here. I don't know how long, but I know it's over.
When I first found out I was positive, I was devastated. I couldn't believe what I had done to myself.
To live with this disease every day means taking medicines twice a day to help myself to stay healthy.
I've been on HIV treatment for over 10 years now. I take medication every morning and then every night.
Every day I have to take 27 different medications because I have had AIDS for more than 28 years.
Sometimes you feel like your stomach doesn't want to handle more pills and you just want to skip that day.
There are so many things that people are afraid of, and the reason that people are afraid of it because they don't know, or nor do they understand, and choose not to learn.
To be honest with you, I kind of have sympathy for those people because I was those people at one time.
I've even had friends who go home and their parents know that they're HIV positive and still they put out paper plates and paper napkins and paper spoons so they can use and just throw them straight in the trash because they're so afraid that they're gonna get it.
I've had family problems and I've been shunned from parts of my family. Ignorance or no knowledge of the fact or trying to ignore the fact is the most dangerous thing of all.
There's a lot of stigma with HIV and AIDS.
We can't end this epidemic without getting rid of stigma.
They shun us. We're not poison.
You want to try to have friends, and you want to be honest, and you tell them about about you being positive, you know, and they reject you.
And you find so many people that are out there now that are homeless strictly because they can't go around family, because of the disease that they have. Or they actually hiding what they have because if they found out, I'm gonna get cut off from my family.
World AIDS Day is remembering all those we have lost to AIDS. And it's also remembering the 34 million people that are living with HIV or AIDS.
This day is very important to anyone that is affected and infected by AIDS.
This day is important to bring about awareness and prevention.
For me, when World AIDS Day come around, it's an opportunity for me to recognize that I'm still here, that I still have the opportunity, just the same as the next man do, to keep pushing. It's just so much motivation.
World AIDS Day is something for getting the word out to the general public.
Being able to discuss this with somebody and talk to somebody is like, man, that is therapy in itself.
It's recognition, it's remembering, it's advancing our goal to end the HIV/AIDS epidemic.
It's
it's not the end of your life. Only because you get diagnosed with a disease, you don't die.
It's not something that you have to be sad about. I mean, if it happened to you, it already happened, and just have to keep going.
I cling on to this life and cherish it so much.
It wasn't the end of the world that I did have a chance to have a productive life, just like anybody else.
We've come a long way in 30 years. People aren't falling off the face of the earth anymore. You can survive.
People are freaks. People get tattooed for all kinds of different reasons.
It's empowering to people.
It just makes you look better. It changes your image.
Gets the stigma with them. You know, the whole, you know, bad person thing.
There's some sort of a spiritual connection.
They want to express the loss of a loved one.
Customize your body.
I'd say it's a fashion accessory, really.
I just think they're cool.
People are really getting in touch with themselves when they get a tattoo.
I mean, it's a very conscious decision to alter your appearance forever.
It's a pretty powerful thing.
I think it was quite intimidating years ago to go into a tattoo place.
Back in the days, it used to be sailors and gangsters and stuff like that.
We're not tattooing gangsters and we're not tattooing bikers.
We've got customers that come in that are lawyers and nurses and
soccer moms and doctors and
footballers. So your idols having them, your actresses.
Nowadays it's everybody.
Coming a little more mainstream now because, you know, TV shows has helped out the tattooing industry a lot.
It's on TV, it's socially acceptable to a certain degree.
After that Miami Ink came out, for about a good year, we're doing nothing but koi fish. I'm a third generation tattoo artist. My name is Bob Shaw. I've been tattooing 19 years. My grandfather tattooed, my dad tattooed, I tattooed. We've got ink in our blood.
There's a big difference between a tattooist and a tattoo artist.
Good tattoos are the tattoos that I do. The bad tattoos, the tattoos other people do.
The tattoo artist, I think that's really important.
I bring them into this world by communicating with them.
I'm brutally honest with people, and some people love me for it, some people hate me for it.
Kind of like being a psychologist, you know, we sit here and we hear all kinds of stuff.
Can we reschedule?
I'm 6 months away from 40. So maybe it's a midlife crisis, I don't know. You work it out.
You're an artist, plus you gotta hear everybody. You gotta give therapy to people, kind of.
Everything is, you know, got a story behind it. Rock star status.
Rock star, you are a rock star.
When you first start tattooing, you think you're a rock star.
It's not really a job, it's a lifestyle.
No matter where you're at, I could be at Six Flags. Everybody wants to talk to the tattoo guy, you know what I mean? So it is kind of rock star-ish.
We do get in some places for free and get free drinks every once in a while.
Everybody goes through that rock star mentality.
Everybody thinks it's the whole rock star status, and it's so fun. And, you know, sit here for 14 hours a day, 6-7 days a week. It'll wear on you. Pain is all in your head.
All tattoos are going to hurt. Some areas are going to be a lot more sensitive than others.
That's a good spot right there.
Most people don't have the mindset.
Agony. It's sore.
The little girls usually do better than the ball players.
We have a higher threshold of pain.
I think it's the way they feel. I think they feel good when you get them.
Some people cry. Some people act like you're beating them to death.
Is it tickle?
It's crazy, all the different reactions.
It's a pain that's almost enjoyable. I don't know if there's endorphins like right now.
I'm a nice guy.
It's actually kind of addicting. You get one, you want more.
It's an addicting fix. It's a good addiction.
I'm not sure why I feel the need to get it. You know, more tattoos after this, but it's a feeling.
After you've gotten your first tattoo, it's like a crack addiction or a heroin addiction.
On my card, it says, welcome to your new addiction. It's true.
A lot of people find their tattoos a pleasurable experience due to the chemical reaction that comes along with it. So a lot of people get hooked on that as well, kind of like a drug.
Just like in typical addict fashion, you just don't have enough.
Most rewarding part would be the look on someone's face when they check it out for the first time in the mirror.
It's a big payoff
just being able to change somebody's life in a short time that you're going to see them.
Feel different now?
I do.
It's nice to have to know that someone's going to be walking around with your artwork on their body for the rest of your, you know, their life.
Get to touch the lives of other people that normally, looking the way I do, wouldn't give me the time of day.
It's about the only thing that has never gotten old.
Best job in the world. You finish a tattoo and then they look at it in the mirror, the finished product, and they smile and they laugh. It's just a good feeling. You can tell they love it.
Of course, I was being raised by my mom and dad, and they had problems with drugs and stuff.
Hold on to me as we go.
She was taking me to my first foster home.
As we roll down this unfamiliar road.
Then things started going downhill.
And although this stringing us along.
Hugh Springs, Texas, Linden, Mineola, Texas.
Just know you're not alone.
Douglasville, Texas, Tyler.
Cause I'm gonna make this place your home.
I just really needed some support.
Settle down, it'll all be clear.
I wasn't thinking I'm gonna have a family.
Don't pay no mind to the demons, they fill you with fear.
It was very lonely.
Trouble in my drag you down. You get lost, you can always be found. Just know you're not alone. Cause I'm gonna make this place your home.
She's like, there's families that want to adopt you.
I read about her and just something in me just stirred that I just couldn't forget about her. I remember going to bed that night thinking, am I crazy? This girl's 17 years old.
Felt like we were called to adopt, and whatever that means, I'm good with.
By the time we met her, we felt like we already knew her.
I gave them a hug and things, and then we sat down, and it was just like, oh wow, like this is really happening.
Instantly, I could just tell from the beginning that her and I were really going to get along well, and that she was a perfect fit for the family.
I got to load all my stuff up and I got to come.
We always felt like the Lord wanted us to have more children.
Settle down, it'll all be clear.
I never saw myself in a home this nice.
Don't pay no mind to the demons, they fill you with fear.
This is what I've learned, that God has a plan for me.
The trouble in my drag.
I was scared that I was going to have to do it alone, and the thing that I was most concerned about was when I grow up and if I get married and have children, you know, who are going to be my good grandparents?
I just can't even imagine the insecurity she must have felt. Just the nights of just laying in bed, being lonely.
It's hard to explain. It's just kind of like love.
That feeling of having somebody now in our home who is safe and who is protected, that we can guide, is why we did it.
There just seems like there's an aspect to our family that Kristen completes.
My mom and dad and my family, they're just gonna be there for me for whatever I wanna do and whoever I wanna be in life. And so my future's gonna be great.
Hi there, my name is Megan Saunders. I'm from Aurora, Colorado. I'm 20 years old, and unfortunately over the weekend I was involved in the Century 16 shooting. I was in Theater 9 in the third row from the front, and we were there as everything went down.
Italian 1 on a shooting, 9 George 2, Century Theaters.
Watch out, we're leaving quickly with victims.
We have 9 shots. We may have a number of people dead inside the theater.
The door kicked open and the entire area was flooded with light, and so we could immediately see the gunman in his full getup. He was dressed head to toe in black. He looked exactly like a SWAT team member. He pulled the shotgun out and shot into the ceiling once. We didn't realize anything was going had gone wrong until he lowered the gun into the crowd.
I got people running out of the theater, they're shot.
We're in a mass casualty situation at this time.
And I was just in shock. I just watched it all happen. I couldn't really comprehend what was happening. And luckily my boyfriend did. He told me to get down immediately, and he shoved me down onto the ground and covered me up with his body. From there, we just listened as the gun went off into the crowd. We were hearing people screaming. It was just utter panic, and we were down there for probably about 2 or 3 minutes while he unloaded the shotgun.
I got 7 down in feet or not.
Any ambos we can get with the gun.
We have every unit that's available in the city of Aurora.
My boyfriend stood up, realized, you know, his back was turned, this was our chance. So he grabbed my hand and jumped over the seats in front of us. He pulled me along with him, and I got caught behind those girls, so my hand fell out of his grasp. But I saw him get over the seats, and I saw him get to the door and out the door just fine. I knew my boyfriend was safe.
Gas being sprayed inside the theater.
I need rescue. I need a medical crew and died. I've got one victim eviscerated.
He was screaming at the police officers, telling them to let him in, that he had to go find me. And it was heartbreaking to know that he was there at the front of the theater. I didn't know if I was okay. Well, I was standing there right looking straight at him, and the relief was just overwhelming. So I ran full force at him, I screamed his name, and I just jumped into his arms. And I think that's one of the happiest moments of my life, just knowing that he was okay. My feeling right now is I'm alive for a reason.